Okay, so he was inspired by modern society in London. What else? Yes.
He was poor growing up, and he wanted to make sure that he had a consistent
Yes, remember, he grew up poor, so he was constantly aware of this idea of how do I make a living as an artist. So, what does he develop as a strategy then? Yes. Well, we'll be looking at a number of his paintings. The paintings were never for sale. The paintings were used to essentially advertise the prints that would be for sale to subscribers. So he has to sell those subscriptions. The subscriptions are essentially the seed money. He needs investors. He's not going to put his own money on the table to have those plates cut and to have all those prints made if there's no guarantee that they're going to sell. So the subscription was his way of essentially guaranteeing that he would make a profit off of this print series and that he could be successful as an artist. As we know, he was very successful with this business model. How did he prevent people from essentially stealing his ideas? Yes?
They made a law called
Yes, yes. Hogarth's Law, or Hogarth's Act, which was essentially a copyright protection. It protected his prints so that another artist simply couldn't take his engraved images and copy them and then make another series of prints. So when we left off, we were looking at one of his series called Marriage a la Mode. So who can sort of give us a rough overview of what we see going on here? Carlson.
So this is a marriage between sort of two families where one is, it's not a marriage of love, but of social climbing, sort of marrying outside the status that you were in. It represents two types of wealthy, one that has spent most of his money, comes from, he says that he comes from nobility, he has all of this air, just full of himself, sort of the canopy, all of that. And then the other side of the family, the other family, is sort of, he's more conservative with his wealth, he wants to not really showboat as much as the other. So the different, like the Viscount and the lady, Hogarth paints the Viscount with his as the son of the one that has spent all of his money, and he actually has syphilis, as shown by his great black spot on his neck and his taking mercury pills, his tablets. The lady dressed in white who suggests an innocence. Is looking in disgust upon the ring that she's presented on the handkerchief to marry the Viscount, and is also sort of interested in this other man, maybe, that is leaning over her shoulder, talking to her.
Okay, good. So we have our major players here. We have a negotiation going on. So we have Lord Squanderfield, who has squandered his money, yet what he does have to barter with is his title. and his lineage. So pointing down to the family tree, we see the use of clothing as a way of indicating somebody's sort of social rank. He gestures to himself. On the other side of the table, we have a self-made businessman. His clothes are much more reserved, more conservative. We don't see lots of flounce, lacy sleeves. We don't see embroidery. We don't see fancy white stockings. And it's more sensible, sort of more sort of British middle class. He is going to exchange the dowry. So he's going to, his young daughter, they have all the money, but they don't have the social status. They don't have the title. So that's the negotiation that's going on between the fathers that we see here. And then as noted on the other side of the room, we have Lord Squanderfield's son, the Viscount, with his equally very French Rococo style fashions, the big bow in his hair, the black mark of syphilis on his neck. He's taking his mercury tablets, and he is enamored with his own beauty as he looks into the mirror, gazing upon himself, completely unconcerned with his future bride-to-be, who is seated next to him, who appears very distraught in this arranged marriage. And as I noted last time, Hogarth frequently uses dogs as a way to sort of make an additional commentary on a scene. So we have the two dogs in the corner, and I know it gets lost in the shadows here, but they are shackled together at the neck, referring then, of course, to the marriage of the young couple. And just as we were leaving, I was going to pick up with this gentleman. So we see another male figure in the scene, dressed in black. He is leaning in, and he is very clearly whispering to that young bride-to-be. He is one of the family attorneys. And his name is identified by Hogarth as Silver Tongue. And he is essentially whispering sweet nothings in this young lady's ear. He sees an opportunity here. So he becomes an indicator of the direction that this marriage is going to take in the scenes to come. Now take note, you know, one of the things to always be aware of in art at this time period is this phenomenon of a picture in a picture. And again, we saw that when we looked at Dutch art, and we see it again here on the back wall. You see these grand gold frames that we associate then with wealth and status. And while most of the scenes sort of get lost in the shadows here, this one is quite interesting. It's a framed circular painting, and I don't know if you can make it out, but it is the face of a woman screaming. If you had a slightly better or clearer image, you'd see that the woman has serpents in her hair. You might recall when we looked at Caravaggio, I showed you a representation of the beheaded Medusa with the serpents writhing in her hair. That is Hogarth quoting Caravaggio. He's using then the image of Medusa. Look how that frame is then sort of angled so that it comes to a point. And it lines up directly so that it falls between this couple. So she's sort of screaming out in horror at this arranged marriage. Hogarth, this is nothing in his scenes. Now in the next scene, so let's see. On your list, you just have the marriage contract. I was here, over there. Yes. So if you got this on a test, I would be specifically asking you at least the symbolism and the questions of the narrative in this image. But I am going to sort of very quickly sort of take you through the other painting so you kind of see how his overall narrative. This is the breakfast scene, which is the next painting in the sequence that he creates. So here we are, the young couple, they're wedded bliss, not really. And it is a morning scene. So we see the couple seated on either side of the fireplace. She's yawning and stretching. And you might be able to see she cuts her eyes to the side. But she is stretching, she's looking over at her husband on the other side of the fireplace. And notice the fireplace really doesn't have a fire in it. It just has some sort of smoky embers here. And the reference is that kind of there's no passion,
there's no fire
between these two. And there's great irony with the fact that look at the painting directly above the fireplace, it's Cupid. Again, another figure that we associate with love, but we also know there's no love between these two. So while she is stretching, as you can see, she's taking her tea or her coffee. As we look around the room, we see that things are a bit sort of disrupted. Furniture has been turned over. We have a musical instrument, a violin, that's sort of partially out of its case. Musical books strewn about on the floor. As we look into the back room, we see a gentleman who is sort of stumbling through the room, also kind of waking up. Candle here, the smoke just sort of wafting out, but we just have a little bit of candle left, meaning the candles have been burning all night at the house. This is actually a pile of playing cards that has been dumped on the floor. So these are indications that she's been entertaining. They had a party at the house. In contrast to the appearance of the young wife, and whoever her visitor is over here, he is dressed in going out clothes. He didn't stay home. He still has his hat on. He still has his coat on. Oh, this is a black spot. That's not going anywhere. Yes. Little doggy. The little dogs are always there to help us. Tucked into his coat pocket, our ladies under things. So she's been entertaining at her house. He's been out on the town entertaining in his own way. So they're leading these very immoral separate lives, which Hogarth is saying, well, this is the result of you didn't marry for love. So you're living separately. This gentleman that you see here, who has this expression of complete disgust with this situation, eyes rolling up, hands going back. He's walking away from the scene. Untucked underneath his arm is a ledger. And here we have a pile of bills and no money. So this becomes a reference to this couple. They have acquired this dowry as a result of this arranged marriage. They're burning through their money. So they are spending unwisely, and this is an indicator, again, of a problem to come. Now, there's some, you know, kind of in typical with Hogarth, always look at the picture within the picture. I pointed out the Cupid, but as we look at the back wall going into the dining room, you have these paintings, vertical paintings of saints, which certainly don't belong in the dining room. And this is Hogarth's way of saying, you may have money, but you don't taste. And what else doesn't belong in a dining room? What is that a picture of? An odalisque. Remember when we looked at like the Venus of Urbino? We just see the foot. Because these works were typically shown the curtain over that. So they've obviously pulled the curtain back, but the fact that they have erotica hanging in their dining room is again another indication that there's something wrong with this couple. This is opera night, so the cup of the young bride, here she is preparing to go out. So she is in her toilette, her boudoir, in bed in the background. And she's having her hair done. And then she has all of her friends, her squad, gathered around. We have music that is being played, singers performing. Here's Silver Tongue. So they're going out together. So their affair has obviously ramped up, and they are preparing to go out to the opera together. Now, as you look at the pictures around the room, they are paintings from art history, but they are paintings of seduction. And I flip past it very quickly, but this is Correggio's Jupiter and Io. So this is the actual painting from the 17th century. And here it is referenced on the back wall. So, again, what we have here is an indication of things gone wrong. And to add to this, what do we see down here in the corner? So we have two figures in here, individuals obviously of African descent or Indian descent. This is also an indicator of the time period of England and the colonies, and how the British are treating then people of other cultures. So they are presented here as essentially the help. But this young boy wearing the turban, you have all of these little objects strewn about on the floor. He's pointing to this figure, and he's looking directly out at you, the viewer. This is a reference to being cuckold.
Oh, wow.
So what does that mean? You're basically on the right track.
Yeah.
So there, here again, we have this reference to that she's very openly having an affair. I'm out of order. Okay. In the next scene, well, here we see him. So here is our Viscount Squanderfield. He's now Lord Squanderfield because his dad has died and he's inherited all the wealth. And they are in an apothecary store. Apothecary is, of course, where you would go to get medication, searching for a healer. So here we see then the healer. And he is accompanied in this apothecary with two other individuals. Now here we see a woman. Do you notice anything distinctive about the woman?
Yes.
So she is a prostitute, and she has come to the apothecary to get her mercury tablets to treat her syphilis. Here is the young lord with all of his fancy attire. He's also holding out his little tin, like, hey, need a refill. He still has his little problem. What do you notice about this figure? Small.
She's sick.
She is dabbing her lip, and that gesture of dabbing the lip is an indicator of somebody that has oozing syphilis sores. And she also has a little box in her hand, so she is there also. Let's get back to the scale of her. Her size tells you what?
She's young.
Age. Yes. This is a child. This is a child that he has infected with syphilis. So this is a young prostitute that he has infected. So he has brought her in to the apothecary for treatment. Okay, so this situation comes to a head. The evening that she goes to the opera with Silvertongue, after the operatic performance, she and Silvertongue decide to check into, I don't want to call it a hotel because you don't actually have hotels at this time period, an inn. They take a room for the night. And they just so happen to have taken a room for the night just down the hall from where her husband has also taken a room for the night with his prostitute. He catches wind that she and Silvertongue are there. So he comes in and he challenges Silvertongue to a duel. So he has burst into the room. He has challenged Silvertongue to a duel. Silvertongue, in his nightie, is escaping out the back window. He has dropped his sword, which is covered in blood because he has stabbed Lord Squanderfield. And Lord Squanderfield drops his sword. He is staggering as he is preparing to die. And she suddenly kneels. Oh, please forgive me. And then in the final scene, he has died. So she is now a widow. Here she is. This is her father. You always count on a parent show up when you really screw up. He is there to pay her debt. So they are collecting on the debts that they have accrued. Notice they're not in a very fancy home anymore. They're in a much simpler, plain home. Her father is stripping her of her jewelry in order to pay off the debts that she has accrued. References such as the starving dog to the side, references, of course, the poverty that they are living in. You have what's left of her followers or her retinue. And she is in the process of essentially dying. She is saying goodbye to the child. Do you notice anything about the child? The child also, as a result of their immoral behavior, has been born and has syphilis. And if you look even closer, actually right here, the child has braces on her leg. So again, the reference is because of their immoral behavior, the next generation or their offspring essentially has been damned, not just with the illness, but they have a physical disability as a result also. So here is sort of Hogarth's ultimate condemnation of what happens if you marry for money and you do not marry for love. Yes?
Is she dying of syphilis?
There's some discussion about that. Some say that she's dying of syphilis and some say that she is dying of an opium overdose. It hasn't been clearly explained. There's been some question about why this guy is sort of punching the other guy because apparently his he had some hand in whatever has happened to her. But she is dying at this point. The open window with the cross over the window, referencing this sort of idea of the end of time, with the clock at the top, a still life overflowing with food when there is no true food. So this is how all of Hogarth's stories go, is that he sets it up about somebody that is social climbing, whether it's a girl coming from the country to seek her success in an urban space, which is Harlot's Progress, which is one of his other series, or The Rake's Progress, which is the downfall of a young man who inherits wealth but doesn't live a moral lifestyle, or if you marry out of your social status that you're born into. Now, as I mentioned, these are turned into engravings. This is what you would buy. So the engravings are all in reverse of the paintings, as the nature of a print. And after you view the paintings and you decide, I like this story, you would again pay your subscription fee, you would get a receipt from Hogarth, and when the plates were cut and the images were printed, you would be able to come and pick up then your series of images. And these were wildly popular. Even though he's actually making fun of the very audiences he is portraying in these prints. They're eating it up. This sort of social satire and critique that he is producing. The British take great delight in figuring out who's who in each image, figuring out the story, and even gossiping about perhaps who is being referred to in these images. We already talked about Gainsborough and Mr. and Mrs. Andrews from last time. Now this brings us up to Benjamin West. This is a portrait of the painter Benjamin West. Benjamin West is our first artist born in North America. He is often identified as one of the earliest American or artists that we would associate with the U.S. or American art history. But of course, he's living in a British colony. He's technically a British citizen. And he will only remain in the area of essentially Philadelphia until he's right around your age, perhaps a little bit younger, and then he leaves for London and he never returns. So he is one of these artists that, again, sometimes I teach him when I teach American art, I always teach him when I teach British art. He's kind of got a foot in both camps. He really is sort of he's a colonial artist. As a painter, he's interesting, and his background or his history growing up in the colonies actually adds to his success. So, the British regard Native Americans, and this is not new to anybody, as being savages. This is part of the racial hierarchies of British society and English society at this time period. They regard the colonists as being one step above the Native Americans. They see them as very living essentially close to nature. So colonists were actually a subject of fascination among the British. Benjamin West would learn this, and he would use this then to his advantage. As I mentioned, he grew up in just outside of Philadelphia. His father was an innkeeper. There was no way to study art extensively in the colonies. There were no museums that you could go to. There were limited examples of fine art in the colonies. There were some, but it was limited. In fact, even the struggle to get art supplies, getting oil paints in the colonies, that was a luxury that had to be shipped in. So West essentially taught himself art. He studied art books that were printed and would be imported into the colonies. He did apprentice with a printmaker in Philadelphia. The printmaker essentially specialized in painting and scenes of the port of Philadelphia. When he felt he could go no further, he left then the colonies and he traveled to Europe. Initially, he departed on what was referred to as the Grand Tour. His goal was not simply to go to London and to stay, but to go over to Europe, to go to France, and in particular to go to Italy. Travel to Rome to study classical art, to travel to Florence to study the Renaissance. Gaining essentially a classical art education. After he completed that, then he traveled to London, where he tried to make a living as a professional artist. The problem when he arrived in London is he's not all that skilled as a painter yet, and the competition was pretty stiff. He was up against people like Sir Joshua Reynolds, who was the president of the Royal Academy. He was up against people like Gainsborough, Mr. and Mrs. Andrews' portrait. Most people were producing portraits in London. They were established names. He was up against people like Hogarth. So how do I compete in this art market? He wanted to get noticed. So he produced a painting that was designed to essentially get him noticed. And this is perhaps one of the most famous paintings of the time period. It was reproduced more than any painting of the era as a print. This is The Death of General Wool by Benjamin West. This piece wasn't commissioned, meaning it wasn't commissioned by like Wolf's family or anything. He came up with this as a theme for a painting that he wanted to submit to the annual Royal Society exhibition. The Royal Society is what existed prior to the establishment of the Royal Academy in London. In order to get your work featured at the Royal Society and to get noticed by the public, really needed to do something sort of astonishing. This is what he submits. Initially, the critics were kind of tickled by it. This American submitting this large-scale painting, The Death of General Wolfe. It was kind of curious because it's the first of its kind. What this is an example of, it's history painting. So we've seen history painting. Who can remind us of history painting first? portraits, still lifes. And we saw a lot of history painting. What is history painting?
Carlson.
Referring to history painting, I'm referring to a very specific type of subject in art history. It's the most important subject in all of art history. History painting. What? Yeah. What is history painting? How is it different from genre painting? How is it different from still lifes, landscapes? Portraits.
Does it tell a story across time?
No.
Or no?
No story across time.
The allegory of government? Or...
No? Yes.
Is it a documentation of like something that happened in history?
Okay, like what?
So this had to have been like a crucial moment in a storyline of either.
No, we're getting off track again. I'm talking in general history.
Wasn't that actually there?
Can anybody give me an example of history painting that we have seen? History painting in this class. Give me an example.
The one with Jesus and the tax collectors and the disciples. Mm-hmm.
Yes. Give me another.
Handing over the business and money.
Yes. Give me another.
Philosophy.
Yes. Give me another.
Oh, this history painting is
very good. History painting in art history up to this time period. If I use the term history painting, I am referring to biblical subject matter or classical mythology. There is no other form of history painting. You could have said the Sistine Chapel ceiling. You could have said the Holy Trinity. That's history painting. The birth of Venus. History painting. What Benjamin West does is he paints contemporary history, current events. That was not done. What? Contemporary events. Basically a new subject within the label of history painting, contemporary history painting. Never done before?
Mm-hmm. There weren't battle scenes and such before this?
Not general. Specific to a particular person, a particular moment, a particular day, a particular time. This, with the establishment of what is termed history. So he essentially invents the concept of contemporary history. It's excused by the Royal Academy because the belief is the silly American doesn't know any better. The silly American, though, did this because he was trying to figure out, how do I capture the public's attention? Just like with Hogarth, he realized success lies with your audience. How do I get the audiences that will be visiting this exhibition to talk about my art, to notice it? How about if I stir their patriotism? So he doesn't just select any moment, he selects a scene from the French and Indian War. This is not the American Revolution, folks. This is the French and Indian War. So here we have then this reference to the tension between, once again, the British and the French. Just like Hogarth despised the French, West is then going to capitalize on his audience's dislike for the French, and particularly in relation to this battle and this loss of this young leader, General Wolfe. The death of General Wolfe. General Wolfe was regarded as a young, heroic general, a British general, who would lose his life on the battle of the city of Quebec on the Plains of Abraham. His death was retold in the newspapers. There would be published descriptions of it. However, this is not what his death looked like. This was a battle to end a 3-month siege at the city of Quebec. That morning, General Wolfe had gone out into battle and he had been shot through his hand. After being shot through his hand, he went to went to the medic's tent to get treatment, had his hand bandaged up, and then he went back into battle later that afternoon. Later that afternoon, he was shot through the torso with a musket ball. That was the fatal blow. He didn't die instantly. He was taken off of the battlefield by his men. He was taken over to essentially be treated by a field medic underneath a tree. I believe there was one other person that was present at his death. It was not this glorious, magnificent, heroic death surrounded by those that admired him. It was a quiet, sad death that happened under a tree out in the middle of nowhere. But what Wes does is he aggrandizes his death. He transforms this from just a moment, a quiet moment, into this spectacular historical moment. So here we see General Wolfe. He has been shot through the hand. His hand is bandaged. You see just a little bit of blood on the gauze from that early wound. And then here we see his men gathered around him as he falls back into their arms as he lays dying from the musket ball that has gone through his torso. You can imagine, he's creating this scene here of drama. It's not a quiet, peaceful scene. There's a clamoring of his men gathered around him, tending to him, trying to offer comfort to him as he reclines back dying. This gentleman has a cloth and he's applying pressure to the wound. Nobody knows about that wound. There's no blood.
There's like one drop.
I personally have never seen anybody shot through the torso with a musket ball, but I'm going to assume there's blood. So we have a tiny little drop of blood cascading down. Now why not show the reality of war? Well, it's focusing on his death. Why not show the reality of his death? Yeah,
Nick? Maybe it's to make him seem weak because he's like crying over this one little spill of blood.
Does Benjamin West want the British general to look weak, though, to a British
officer? This was the French general.
No, this is the British Wolf. Yes. He wants to show a military leader with no dignity. Think about how during times of war, you don't want representations of US soldiers shown in the media with their bodies devastated by war. So it's this idea of trying to present them as fallen hero with a dignified death. So downplaying the gore of war. And the other side of this is art still is very much about an ideal. You don't want to horrify your viewer with something that makes them go, oh! Instead, it's a more idealistic representation of death. In fact, this idealistic representation of death is directly based on another work of art. Let's look at this for a second. We have a figure reclining back. He has a wound in his hand. He has a wound on his side. He has people gathered around him at his death. And he has here the Union Jack swept up in a bundle of fabric behind him. The death of General Wolfe represents what, Camilla?
The death of Jesus?
Christ, yes, absolutely. West is essentially representing Wolfe as the sacrifice. He is Christ. His death here then is not gory, much like a sculpture that he would have seen when he came through Italy in Rome, the Pietà. The death here is slipping into a peaceful slumber. Instead of the cross rising up behind him, we have then what he has died for is the flag. And look at the hat. As it has fallen into the immediate foreground, it has the British crown on. So these type of images then are what he's drawing inspiration from in terms of just the general compositional arrangement of the descent from the cross scene. Now, all of these men that are gathered around, so we have the battlefield in the background. We have the plumes of smoke billowing off of the background. We see then the battle raging off in the distance as the French and the British troops collide. These people who are all gathered around him, who were not present at his death, yet each one of these is a portrait of a known person in London at this time period. So what West has done is he has painted people into this historical moment. They weren't there. Now they are. So he has incorporated portraiture of these individuals. There's actually a key somewhere which identifies each one of these people. And they look on in horror and concern and grief and pity for their fallen hero. While this is going on, we have this going on. Anchoring the foreground with the representation of the Native American. That would attract the attention of the British public more than the image then of a fallen hero and his death would be the exoticness of a Native American. So this was to immediately sort of attract then the curiosity of the viewer's eye. Look, a Native American, drawn by a colonist who would have seen one. West understood that and played it up. West never in his life saw a Native American while he was growing up in Philadelphia. At that time period, they had already been moved off of that area. They weren't there anymore. But he uses a story. He even creates his own biographical story. Because they're like, oh, you're an exotic colonist. You saw a Native American, and that must be an authentic representation of the Native American. West, yes, Native Americans taught me how to paint. They took me down to the river and they showed me how to combine bear fat and mud to make paint, which is a complete lie. But the British were like, really? This Native American is a stereotype. He does not represent any particular tribe. The objects
are all objects that he, West, kept in his studio as props. In fact, these objects are actually now in the British Museum collection. So he brought these or purchased them in London and used them as props when he was creating his representations of Native American. The figure conforms to the stereotype of what British viewers expect to see. From their point of view, this is what a Native American is. Partially clothed, feathers, beads, barefoot, even the required tomahawk. That becomes then that sort of symbolic convention of Native Americans. He uses this figure not just to attract the attention of the British audience, he uses them and for a couple other reasons. Notice that he is the figure that is unclothed. Now this of course conforms to the British perception of Native Americans as being savage, so he's showing him as different versus the fully dressed British that are around him. But he's also showing his audience, I've mastered the classical, idealized male figure. He's trying to demonstrate his skill. He's trying to prove to a European audience that I have all the same skills that you people have. Now, his positioning of the Native American, in addition to it sort of conforming to that stereotype of the quote-unquote savage. Notice his reaction in relation to the reaction of the Europeans and the British that are gathered around the death of General Wolfe. Everybody else has expressions of concern, anguish, grief. The Native American is represented as calm and detached, unreacting. Objectively looking onto a scene. And this is West again representing that negative stereotype. Oh, the Native American couldn't possibly understand this. He doesn't understand the depth, he doesn't understand the importance of this moment. Now, above, we have this figure. What do you notice about this figure?
He's not British.
What tells you he's not British?
His clothing.
His clothing. His clothing. Now he is wearing a Western or a European style coat and a European style hat. But as we look closer, we see that he has a beaded hat band. He has a beaded pouch across his torso. He is wearing buckskin leggings. And he is wearing moccasins. He is the representation of the colonist. So this is how West is sort of dividing everybody out. Native, colonies, British. This is William Johnson, I believe was his name. He was actually the director of Indian Affairs at this time period. And he was at this battle. Now he is arriving at the scene, and you can see with his dramatic gesture here, he's looking down towards the death of General Wolfe, but with his hand, he gestures back. With his other hand, he's doing this. Arriving to the scene, hey guys, I got news. And here's another figure, he's coming out of the corner, waving his hat. He is bringing news that the battle is because according to sort of the legendary death of General Wolfe, after he was shot through by the musket ball, he lay dying under the tree. He would not die until he received word that the British had taken the upper hand in the battle and were about to win. So according to the legend, he basically uttered something to the extent of, now I can die. And at that moment, that's the moment we're seeing here. So he's getting word. His eyes are rolling upwards. His lips have parted. He's uttered the words, now I can die. And notice what happens to the sky. The clouds sweep this way on the battlefield. The light is coming down onto him. And it's this moment of,
as if he's about to go up into heaven. Now I can die. It's this incredible, dramatic, theatrical sort of stage set representation of the death of General Wolfe. Nothing realistic about it, but it made for a good story. And it was based on an actual event, however reinterpreted by the artist to make it more appealing to his audiences. The painting would actually be so successful that he had it turned into an engraving. There's actually three copies of it three versions that exist. It is the original and two copies. So it was so popular that two other people requested a copy of the same image. And so that he didn't lose any money in this, he had the entire painting translated into an engraving and then sold the engravings for profits. There is another version of The Death of General Wolfe by another artist, Barry, and it's a funny image when you compare it to this version of The Death of General Wolfe. It literally is a tree, a dead Native American, and General Wolfe dead. So this sort of grand, sort of theatrical, operatic version of death and dying. Ooh, man down. Okay.
Can I ask, would you consider that tenebristic lighting on?
That's a good question. So what you see in this painting, if we were going to put a stylistic label on this type of contemporary history painting, in the British tradition, we would call this the Grand Manor. And the Grand Manor is essentially borrowing bits from the Baroque tradition, where you have dramatic energy, dramatic movement, you have dramatic clouds, and you work with some dramatic lighting, but it's not true tenebristic lighting. Tenebristic lighting really does have to have those areas of complete blackness, and then the solitary figure sort of cast in light. We do have dramatic lighting, but not to the degree of tenebristic lighting.
And you said dramatic from
this type of lighting is often associated with the Grand Manor.
Yes, which comes from Venice.
It's essentially a style developed by the British. It borrows some elements from the Baroque, but it is not Baroque style. Okay. Now this moves us to our next slide sheet. So here we're picking up with Neoclassicism. Concept sort of movement back and forth. So neoclassicism is new classicism. It's a new interpretation on the classical past. Neoclassicism is a style. This is where students always start to get confused. A style. It is not a subject. So you can have painting after painting of classical subject matter, that doesn't mean it's neoclassical in style. And you'll see as we move through Dugin's work. Neoclassicism is a stylistic movement that emerges in England, but also in France. And we're starting off with France here. This is Jacques-Louis David. Looks like David, but it's pronounced David. Neoclassicism is a reaction against Rococo. So remember Rococo, frothy, light, loose brushwork, pale pink pastels. Neoclassicism then returns us to clarity, order, focus. The leading artist associated with this development of the neoclassical is Jacques-Louis David. Okay, how did David get there? David started off as a court artist for poor Louis XVI. Oh, I feel bad for Louis XVI. So remember when we talked about Rococo, that was Louis XV. That was Louis XVI's grandfather. So Louis XV dies, Rococo starts to be phased out, and we start to move towards the neoclassical. Of course, Louis XVI marries Maria Antoinette. Of course, they use their heads in the portrait. Okay. When Jacques-Louis started off as an artist, he worked in the Rococo style. These are both by Jacques-Louis. Both represent the Rococo style. So on one hand, we have sort of the country maiden, frolicking. We have Cupid, we have lots of pinks and pastels. This is a continuation. This is where we begin to see a transition. So this is also by Jacques-Louis David. David worked as a court artist for Louis XVI. Increasingly in France, there was a growing interest in the classical past. Classical subject matter, as well as what will inspire this new classicist style. Now, what's driving this return to the classical? Partially, we can look to the rediscovery of Herculaneum and Pompeii. These Roman cities, which had been covered over by ash when Mount Vesuvius erupted. British, German, French gentlemen would make their way into Italy, and there was this growing interest with studying then the classical past. They were bringing back ruins, they were bringing back sculptures, they were collecting, technically they were stealing, and they were bringing all this stuff back. This is what will wind up eventually in the British Museum. So this drives an increased interest, but David will go from this to this. This is neoclassicism. So the shift that he is making here is notable on a number of different levels. Now in this, this is the Oath of the Horatii. Sometimes you'll hear people pronounce it Horati. This is considered the epitome of neoclassical style. This painting in neoclassical style happens to feature classical subjects. So let's sort those two things out. what makes this neoclassical in style?
No visible brushwork. There is a return to sharp, clear focus. No more of this loose brushwork, no more of these blurry edges and soft focuses. Clarity, focus, sharp lines, clear edges. Let's see if I have some. The reapplication of the rules of the past, classical proportion of the figures. They're not the fleshy, voluptuous, Rubenesque figures of the past or the Rococo figures. Instead, they're back to those muscular, classical, idealized figures, represented in classical proportion. Using one-point linear perspective to represent space, focused and clear. You're not getting lost in background and foreground, the background and the middle ground, where you kind of just move off into wherever here. Instead, you have a shallow representation of space, much like a theatrical backdrop, or much like a classical relief. So everything is in the foreground and the middle ground, not in the background. Shallow space. All over lighting. No tenebristic lighting. Balanced all over lighting. Lastly, the neoclassical requires clarity of gesture and expression. You, the viewer, should be able to walk up to these works of art and very clearly read the body language and understand what's going on in the scene. It should not require a book of signs and symbols. I mean, who the heck knows? But here, reduction of figures. We don't have as many figures as we can possibly cram into the scene. We only have the figures in the scene that we need to tell the story. So almost what we would often refer to as sort of economy of form. Being very selective and specific about the figures that are included so we tell a very concise story. Okay. We'll stop here and we'll come back to neoclassicism, style, and subject. Have a good week, guys.